Good evening, everyone. Let's start now. So today I want this session to be really very interactive. So if you have questions, you are free to ask. But as an overview, you are going to cover almost every topic by the way of there is this part two examination. I think is very good that we just go over it so that we see how to calculate the metrologies, the sampling, and then those risk assessment procedures. And also, I think we don't have sampling calculations here. That's why I have also separate additional slides with questions on sampling. Okay. So, I just want someone to confirm if they can hear me and if they can also see the slides that I'm present, whatever that I'm doing on my screen. Anyone? Okay, thank you very much, thank you very much. Okay, so, okay. So let's start with before we actually start with the question, let's just do an overview of our audit process. Okay, so our audit process is simple. We start with pre-engagement activities. I'm just waiting for this thing to respond. Okay, so I just want to give a brief of so the starting point is pre-engagement activities. Then we go to planning. This is just an overview. Under planning, the main outcomes under planning will be so this is the pre-engagement activities, and then main outcomes under planning will be our audit strategy and also a detailed audit plan. These are the deliverables under for planning, and then from planning we go to okay, so from planning, we go to obtaining audit evidence. Under obtaining evidence, we have choices here. We can use test of controls, I just call them TOCs, and then we can use substantive procedures. Substantive procedures. So these are the two ways that we can obtain audit evidence using. Then under substantive procedures, we have substantive analytical procedures. Then we also have substantive test of details. Okay, so after obtaining the evidence, then we conclude, or rather, we evaluate the audit evidence. Let's say we evaluate and conclude. Okay. So this is our audit process. This will be number one, and this for number two, this number three, this number four. Okay, so we have to identify the standards that are applicable under each and every stage. Okay, so this one mainly is SQC1, which is quality assurance for firms that perform audit and review engagements and other assurance service engagements. Then we also have ISA 220, which is quality assurance for an audit of financial statements. We also have ISA 300 is still applicable here. That's planning. And then we also have ISA 610, which is the use of internal, the work of internal auditors. Then we also have ISA 620, which is the use of experts. Then I think the last one is ISA 600, not 630. 600 or 630, I'm forgetting. Okay, that's the audit of group financial statements. So these are the standards that are applicable under pre-engagement activities. Then under planning, the main standards here is obviously our ISA 300, which is planning. ISA 300, then another one that is very important is ISA 315. ISA 240, ISA 315 is about identifying and assessing risk of material misstatement through the understanding of the entity and its environment. Then this one is auditor's responsibility in relation to fraud. 300 is planning. Okay. Then audit strategy, that's when we determine the timing, the direction, and also the scope. So it's STD, the scope, direction, and the scope, timing, and direction. So under this one, we say the main deliverables here to determine the scope of the audit. We will determine also the timing and also the direction. Under this one, we also determine three things, but now in detail. Here we determine the nature of the procedure that we are going to do, also the timing, and then the extent. Okay, so this is what will happen under planning. But mainly the planning process, we start with I'm just trying to summarize. So risk of risk assessment procedures, assessment procedures. Procedures. Then we go to identify and assess risks. Or risk assessment procedure, that's when we understand the entity and its environment, including internal controls. This is 315. Then identify risk and identify and assess risk. Obviously, we can only perform this after risk assessment procedures. Then number three, we go to materiality. And then number four, we go to the strategy, the audit strategy, and also the audit plan. Okay. So under obtaining evidence, that's when we said we can do test of controls, we can do substantive analytical procedures, we can do substantive test of details. Okay. So that is the audit process in short. Okay, so what are we concentrating? Obviously, pre-engagement activities. We should concentrate on that one. Then also planning, the risk assessment procedures and materiality. And then obtaining all the evidence, we are mainly concentrating on test of controls, yes, and also the substantive procedures where we do sampling. So we cover sampling under obtaining audit evidence. Okay, that is the audit process in short. Okay, so let's start with sampling. So we are on the was it part two examination paper? The sampling question was on Actual question number one. Okay, so let's just do the question, the whole question. So first of all, I will show you where does the question fall under this audit process. Then we can try to answer it. Okay, so it's saying you are a senior in charge of the audit of Farmco You are the senior in charge of the audit of Farmco Limited for the financial year ended 31 October 2019. In planning the audit of Farmco Limited, you have obtained the following information. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. So the first one is saying the company imports various pharmaceuticals, both raw material and finished products, from suppliers in the United States of America, India, and Europe. Then the raw materials are processed into sellable pharmaceutical products at Farmco Limited Laboratories in Bulawayo. Farmco Limited markets pharmaceutical products in Zimbabwe and in Central African countries in anticipation of the Zimbabwean dollar, which was at par with the South African rand, deteriorating against the US United States dollar. Farmco Limited purchased substantial quantities of pharmaceuticals toward the end of October. This purchase resulted in the inventory balance increasing from 2.8 at the end of 2018 financial year to 3.6 at 31 October 2019. At 31 October 2019, most of the inventory is stored locally, but a significant quantity is also stockpiled in public third-party warehouse in other African countries. The changed political situation in Zimbabwe has resulted in increased competition in the pharmaceutical industry. The summary trading results of the financial position of Farmco Limited for the previous financial year, as well as the draft figures for the current year, are as follows. Of year in 2019 and also 2018. So our current year is 2019, prior year is 2018. So we have revenue, we have profit before tax, we have profit after tax, we have dividends, and then we have ordinary share holders equity, and then total assets. So the requirement is compute with reasons the performance materiality figures you deem appropriate for use when planning and performing the audit of financial statements of Farmco Limited for its financial year ended 31 December 2019. So this question is particularly falling under this part. The planning part. Okay. So the second question is saying discuss your assessment of audit risk in respect of the inventory balance reflected in Farmco statement of financial position as at 31 October. Again, it's under planning. That's when we do risk assessment procedures, and also we identify and assess. Here the question is saying discuss your assessment of audit risk. So we are going to identify the risk in the scenarios described above, then we assess the risk. Okay. So it's saying then number B is about sampling. Okay, so let's start with materiality. So before we calculate materiality, let's just give a brief discussion of materiality. So we normally have four levels of materiality. We have what we call our starting point, we call overall materiality. Then number two, the second will be the performance materiality. Materiality. Then number three, we have what you call clearly trivial threshold. Then number four, we have what we call a specific lower level materiality for specific account balance. Or classes of transactions or disclosures. Disclosures. Okay, so in this case, our requirement is to calculate performance. It's saying compute with reasons the performance materiality figures you deem appropriate for use when planning and performing the audit of financial statements of Farmco Limited for its financial year ended 31 December 2019. So we are required to compute this one. But we cannot compute performance materiality without first computing overall materiality. So we'll start by computing overall materiality. Okay, so what is it? What is overometrology? Okay, why do we have to calculate it? The primary purpose of calculating overometrology is so that we can determine, it helps us determine the performance metrology. That's the primary purpose of calculating overometrology. Then it also help us to determine whether the financial statements are materially misstated. So the standard about metrology is ISA 320. It says once the accumulated misstatements, that means the accumulated and corrected misstatements, if they exceed our overall metrology, then the auditor should conclude that the financial statements are not free from material misstatements. Okay, so if the aggregate of the uncorrected misstatements, they exceed our performance materiality, then the auditor should conclude that financial statements are materially misstated. Okay, sometimes the auditor may also conclude that the financial statements are misstated, even if the aggregate of those uncorrected misstatements are not really above overall materiality, but they are almost equal to the overall materiality. Okay, of course, you will consider other things besides the materiality level. Okay, so those are the two primary reasons. Then how do we calculate it? First of all, the standard says we have three procedures that we follow. The first thing, we should determine the appropriate benchmark. Appropriate benchmark. Okay, then number two, we should determine the appropriate level of benchmark. Then number three, we should justify the benchmark. Okay, so here we are justifying why we use a certain benchmark instead of the other. Okay, so the standard also say the possible appropriate benchmarks, we have profit before tax. We can use total assets. We can use equity. We can use total income. We can use total expenses. These are all considered appropriate benchmarks. But the problem is, how do we choose between these ones? Okay, so the only problem is, how do we choose between those appropriate benchmarks? Okay, so when choosing an appropriate benchmark, you have to follow again three procedures, or you should consider three things when choosing an appropriate benchmark. Okay, so those things are, the first thing that we need to consider, you need to consider the primary focus of the intended users. Then you need to consider the industry, the entity is operating in. Then you also need to consider the relative volatility of the benchmark. Let's just say benchmark. Okay, so these are the things that you consider. Okay, so the question is, are we going to use profit before tax to compute our overall materiality? If the question is yes, why are you choosing profit before tax instead of total assets? Because all those four or five, the profit before tax, the total assets, the equity, the total income, the total expenses, they are all considered to be appropriate benchmarks by the standard, which is ISA 320. Materiality in planning and performing an audit. Okay, so we need to consider these things. Okay, so we say the first thing is to consider the primary focus of the intended user. So the standard also says, when you are auditing an owner-managed company, so in owner management company, we are saying the owners are also the managers. The first point of call is to consider profit before tax. Okay, so that's the first point. Of course, when you are auditing in owner-occupied, owner-managed company. Okay, so but there are some instances where we might see that it's not possible to use profit before tax. What are those instances? Sometimes we don't use the profit before tax even in the owner-managed companies because normally the profit before tax is highly volatile. Highly volatile. Why is it that? Because you know that profit is affected by many things. When you sell an asset or assets at a loss, you might report a loss for the year because of that sale of the assets, because we record the profit and losses for the sale of an asset in the profit and loss section. So, but you know that it's unlikely that that loss will be repeated in future. Maybe it was just a once-off thing, or you just discontinued an operation. That's why you have made those losses. So you can see that the profit before tax might be highly volatile. So the first, if you see that the profit before tax are highly volatile, the first thing that you do is you consider normalizing it. Okay, so the first thing that you do is you consider normalizing the profit before tax. So what is to normalize profit before tax? Okay, let's say we discontinued an operation and then we made a loss. So we know that that loss will not be repeated in the future. It was just a once-off thing. So what we do, we add it back. So that's normalizing. So even in our situation, as you can see, here we had this scenario where they are saying in anticipation of the, not number four, in anticipation of the Zimbabwean dollar, which was at par with South African rand, deteriorating against the US dollar, Farmco Limited purchased substantial quantities of pharmaceuticals toward the end of the October. These purchases resulting in even rebalance registering from 2.8 at the end of the 2018 financial year to 3.8. So you know, if we have a lot of closing stock, it will also affect our profit, isn't it? It will actually increase our profits. Okay, so that is one example of an abnormal event that is unlikely to be repeated in the future. Okay, that was just an overview. Okay, we said we after identifying an appropriate benchmark, then we determine the level of the benchmark. So normally, the levels that we use, these are not in terms of the standard, but these are just industrial averages. For profit before tax, we normally use what percentage? It should be 5% to 10%. Okay, for total assets, we normally use 1% to 2%, and then for equity, we normally use is it 2% to 5%. Then for what else do we have here? Gross profit is just the same as assets. We use also 1% to 2%. Then there is one thing. Revenue. If you are going to use revenue, we are likely to use 0.5% to 1%. Okay. So these are, that's what I mean by determine the appropriate level of the benchmark. This second scenario, this second step. Okay, so these are considered to be, these are what the big fours are doing. They normally use these levels, these ranges. If it is profit before tax, they use 5 to 10%, depending on the risk level. Then the total assets, 1 to 2%, equity is 2 to 5%, and then gross profit is also the same as total assets. Okay, revenue is 0.5 to 1%. Okay, so the third thing that you do, or the final thing, is to justify the benchmark. Okay, so if you are going to use revenue, why are you using revenue instead of other, this range of appropriate benchmarks? We have profit before tax, we have total assets, equity, total income, total expenses, but now you are choosing total income or revenue. Why are you using revenue instead of the other appropriate benchmarks? Okay, so that's the third step and the final step. Okay. So after determining the overall materiality, let's say we are using revenue, and revenue this year was 10 million. So how do we determine materiality, overall materiality? So I'm going to say overall materiality is equal to maybe the risk of misstatement is high. So we say the 10 million multiplied by 0.5%. Whenever the risk is high, we choose the lower end. But if the risk is low, maybe because of our prior year's experience, we don't expect any misstatements, then that's where you can use 1%, which is the upper end. Or you can even use 0.7% as long as it is still between 0.5% to 1%. To determine whether you are going to use 0.5% or 1%, it all depends with the risk of material misstatements. Okay, that is how you determine overall materiality. Then our question requires us to determine planning our performance materiality. It's saying compute with reasons the performance materiality figures you deem appropriate for use when planning and performing the audit of financial statements of FarmCo. So here, for planning materiality, performance materiality, how do we determine it? The performance materiality, it's simple. If you have calculated the planning materiality, the performance materiality is just the materiality level that is set at below overall materiality to reduce the probability that the aggregate of the uncorrected and undetected misstatements will exceed our overall materiality. So the first thing is performance materiality should be lower than overall materiality, and performance materiality is just a percentage of planning materiality. Planning materiality or overall materiality. Okay, so normally we just choose 50% to a range of 50 to 75%. Okay, so it will be just 75% of overall materiality, or 50%, or any figure. It might be 55%, it might be 70%, depending again on the risk assessment, the overall risk assessment. So in this case, because we said we are expecting misstatements, then we are going to say 50, which is our overall materiality, multiplied by 50%. So this one becomes our performance materiality. Simple to calculate performance materiality. It's just a percentage of planning materiality. Okay, then if the question might ask you to actually calculate performance materiality using 15%, don't say 15% is inappropriate, because we don't, these figures are not in the standard. They are just industrial averages. What Deloitte is doing, what EY is doing, what is KPMG doing, what is Grant Thornton doing. So the analysts, they just come up with averages. They are not according to the standards. Okay. But in the case that they are not given, then you can use this average that we are talking about. For planning, for performance materiality, we use 50% to 75%, depending on the risk assessment level. Okay. That is our performance materiality. The clear trigger threshold is we use this one to accumulate misstatements, usually 5% of overall materiality. Okay. Usually 5% of overall materiality. Then we'll discuss specific lower level materiality very soon. Let's now try to calculate our to answer the question, item number one. We say compute with this and the performance materiality figures you deem appropriate for use when planning and performing the audit of financial statements. So firstly, we say the first point of call is actually to use profit before tax. But in this case, can we use profit before tax? That is the question. Okay, so here, if we consider what is happening on the profit before tax, here, as you can see, we had a profit before tax of 1.450 in the prior year. That was the actual. Then here we have draft, which is actually less than 1 point, which is actually less than prior year. We have 1.1 this year, prior year we have 1.4. But we're actually expecting the profit for this year to be high because of the inventory, high inventory levels that are being kept by the company in anticipation of that USD Zimbabwean dollar deterioration. So that's the first thing that you might need to consider. So what we do is we can actually try to normalize the 1.1. Okay, we also use that analytic that I was doing. We also use when we are now performing analytical procedures when identifying the risk of material misstatement, because this is without outside our expectation. We're expecting the profit before tax to be actually higher than last year, but then it's actually lower. Okay, so we'll use that to identify risk of material misstatement. Okay. So what we are going to do, if we are going to use profit before tax, we know the percent that we are going to use. We can use 5 to 10%. So it will be just 1,100. It will be just 1,100 multiplied by 5% if the risk of material misstatement is high. Okay, so if we are going to use this one. You calculate for both years 2018 and 2019. If we are going to use profit before tax, we said we use 5% or 10%. So say 5%, 10%, 5%, or even in 2018. Sometimes we might use 5% in 2019 and then 6% that we might have used 6% of in 2018. It just depend on the risk assessment on your judgment, professional judgment as an auditor. Okay. So what do we need to consider here? We said the first step is to what? To determine the appropriate benchmark. So in this case, we have many options. We can use revenue, we can use profit before tax, we can use total assets, everything is there. We can use even equity is there. Okay, so the possible appropriate benchmarks, they are all there. So which one are we going to use? If we are going to use revenue, how are we going to justify it? Because the third step is to actually justify the benchmark. Okay, if we are going to use revenue, how are we going to justify it? From the scenario here, we won't be able to justify revenue. That's why it is always appropriate to start with profit before tax. Okay, so since it's a profit-making scheme, it's highly likely that the investors, their focus will be the profit, isn't the profit, the earnings, the returns. Okay, so that is one point that you can actually write on the justification of your benchmark. Okay, so we said because it's highly likely that the focus of the intended users is their earnings or their returns, we are going to use profit before tax. But we have issues of inventories. The 1,100 might not be representative of the underlying performance of the entity because it is affected by the high levels of inventory. So we might say we are no longer going to use profit before tax because of that fact. So what if we are going to use total assets? Total assets is again going to be affected by inventory because inventory is part of the total assets. So it's quite volatile this year because it's affected by a once-off thing. It's highly likely that this one is going to be repeated in the future. Maybe it was just a 2019 thing. Do you think the companies are still overstocking this in 2020, in 2021? No, they are no longer overstocking. So it was just a 2019 thing. So it's also affected by that once-off thing. Another thing that you need to consider on total assets is we might say total assets is appropriate because since you know this is a pharmaceutical industry and they have that lot of inventory, so we might say even the focus of the intended users is now shifted to total assets because they've invested in inventories. So we might say the focus is now shifted to total assets. Okay, so that is how you can discuss when you are calculating mutuality. I might use probe before text as long as I can justify it, because we say the steps are to identify the appropriate benchmark, the appropriate level, and then justify it. If you cannot justify whatever benchmark that we are going to choose, that means don't use it, because we cannot justify it. In this case, I was trying to show you how you can justify the benchmarks. So if you have chosen revenue, that means you are going to use 0.5% depending on your risk assessment. Then you can also use the upper end of 1%. If you are going to use equity, we know that we are going to use 2 to 5%. Then if you are going to use total assets, we know that we are going to use 1 to 2%. Okay, so if you can justify your benchmark, then you can choose any of these benchmarks. Okay, so I'm not going to choose any benchmark for you, but I was just showing you how you can justify your benchmarks. If it was me, I was going to use profit before tax after normalizing it. So how I would normalize profit before tax, I would say 1/100, which is the reported profit. We know that it's including this abnormal stock. So I should, what do I do to have the abnormal stock? Is it, do we add it? Yeah, I think we should, because in Venro, the closing stock increases our stock, so increases our profit, so we add it, then we deduct this normal inventory balance. Okay, this is how you would normalize it, but it was quite tricky to normalize the profit here. So if you cannot normalize the profit, that's when you resort to other benchmarks. Okay, do we have questions on the on mutuality? Because we've actually covered mutuality. Okay, if we don't have questions on mutuality, then we go to what is this? Discuss your assessment of the odd risk in respect of inventory balance reflected in FAMCO statement of financial position as of 31 December. So this one, you are the senior. So want to formulate the strategy that you are going to use to audit inventory. It's risk assessment at a session level. Okay. So the best thing is to actually say, you draw a table, risk indicator, that's the first thing that you do. So you say, okay, risk indicator, you describe the scenario that you think indicates the possibility of the presence of material misstatements. Then you now tell us the risk that you are talking about, and then the assertion that is affected by that risk, and then you have to also indicate the level, risk level. Here we're talking about, is it high, is it low, or moderate? So we're talking about whether the risk is, the first thing is whether the risk is significant, or is just high, or is moderate, or is, how do we call it, or is low. Okay, so as the name suggests, if the risk is considered to be significant, the standard just says, it's 315, it just says significant risk requires special audit considerations. That's the definition. If we require special audit consideration for a certain account, that means we should assess the risk as significant. Then high is just second to significant, then moderate second to high, then low, we don't have much risk in the account. Okay, so this is the table that you can use. I know that your answer sheet won't fit all this, but then you can say risk indicator, then you put the risk here, then you put a section, then you put the risk level. Okay, so this one, let's now go. The question is saying, discuss your assessment of what risk in respect of the inventory balance reflected in FAMCO statement of financial position as of 31 October. So we now go line by item. line by line, you are the senior in charge of the auditor firm call for the financial year ended 31 December. In planning the auditor financial firm call, you have obtained the following information about the company. We said the first one, the company imports various pharmaceuticals, both raw material and finished exports. Foreign are from suppliers in USA, India, and Europe. So this one, we actually have a risk indicator here. What is it? Foreign transactions. This one on its own is actually a risk indicator. Foreign transaction. So what is the risk? Incorrect, or let's say incorrect translation of purchases. We are acquiring inventory using United States dollars or whatever another countries, India, we are using their currency there to acquire the inventory, and also we might be using euros. So then there is a risk that we might use inappropriate rates to convert those euros or those United States dollars or those Indian whatever currents into our functional currency, which is the Zimbabwean dollars. So we said the risk is incorrect translation of purchases, then also incorrect so what is the assertion that is going to be affected by this risk? Obviously, it will be accurate. And also accurate, we are talking about the class of transaction here, then also valuation of inventory. So these are the assertions that are going to be affected by that risk. And then, are we saying this is high? This is always high. This is actually an inherent risk. Whenever we have foreign transactions, we always assess the risk as high. So how many possible marks do we have here? To just indicate the risk indicator is a mark. Then to now say out the risk that is there is another mark. Actually, most of our marks are here on the identification of the risk, but we can only identify the risk when we have an indicator. Then also, it's very important that we show the assertions that are affected by the risk, and also to determine the level. This is subject to professional judgment. This one to say high or low. Okay. So number two, the raw materials are processed into sellable pharmaceutical products at Pharmco Laboratories in Bulawayo. Here, what is the risk indicator? What is the risk here? The risk, you know, the valuation of work in progress is high likely that we might have work in progress here. So we can say a possibility of work in progress. Why? How is possibility of work in progress balances a risk indicator? So it might be the risk is incorrect valuation of work in progress. It might be complex to or we can say complicit in the calculation of work in progress. Those are the two risks. Which assertions? Obviously, it's valuation. And then again, this, whenever we have work in progress, the level of risk is high. Okay, so this is what we do line item by line item. Pharmco makes pharmaceutical products in Zimbabwe and also in Central African countries. Okay, this one we consolidate it with number five. Number five is saying at 31 October 2019, most of the inventory is stored locally, but a significant quantity is also stockpiled in public warehouse in other countries. Okay. So what is the risk indicator here? We can call it offsite inventory Storage, you can call it whatever name that you want. You can call it with consignment here. Okay, let's just call it that one, offsite inventory storage. Because some inventories are stored in other countries which are not Zimbabwe. Let's say we are just a small firm. We might not have the resources to actually send people to go and verify the existence of that inventory. So what is the risk here? The risk is that inventory does not exist. That is the risk. This one will affect our existence of inventory, and this is actually again high. The risk is inventory might not exist, and because we also so because we might not be able to send our orders to go and verify the inventories in those countries, then it's also a detection risk. Okay. Okay, so another thing that we can actually put here, we can also put the odd risk that is being affected, and then for this one we say it should be inherent risk. Then for this one also, it's again inherent risk. It's again in risk, but this one is detection risk. Because it's affecting our abilities as auditors. We might not be able to perform procedures to verify existence of the inventory in those countries. So this is how you could actually do it, line item by line item. We are not going to cover everything, but we are almost there. The changed political situation in Zimbabwe has resulted in increased competition in pharmaceutical industries. So this one also affects going concern. Because as we can see that it actually shows that revenue decreased, maybe due to the competition that is described on note number 6. So it will also filter into our going concern. Then we also, going concern normally is an inherent risk or risk at overall financial statement level. Okay, then number 4, in anticipation of Zimbabwe dollar, which was deteriorating against the US dollar, Farmco purchased substantial quantities of some pharmaceutical toward at the end of October 2019. So since we have a lot of inventory here, because it used to be 2,800 in 2018, but this year we have 3,600. That means we have a bigger balance of inventory at year end. What are the risks there? So the indicator is large quantities of inventory, of closing inventory. Inventory. So how is that a risk indicator? There's an issue of inadequate provision for obsolete stock. I like that whenever we have this lot of inventory, sometimes we might not be able to sell them, sometimes they may become obsolete. So we should provide for them, for the absolute inventory, appropriately. Okay, so there's actually a risk that the valuation assertion is affected here, the valuation. This one affects our valuation and also accuracy. So it's valuation of inventory, then accuracy of the provision for absolute stock. We only talk about accuracy when you are talking about the classes of transactions. But we're not talking about it. Balances, account balances, we'll be talking about valuation. So accuracy and valuation is just the same thing, just a matter of perspective. Which line item are you looking at? If you are looking at all the line items in the income statement, then we are talking about accuracy. Then valuation is all the items that is in the that are in the balance sheet.
Okay. Okay, so do you have questions on the risk assessment procedures?
Do I actually have people on the call? I wonder, you are just too quiet. Modesta, do you have any question? Hey. Ngozi, Melissa, Sanele, Juliana. Oh, you don't have questions? Okay. Okay, it's fine. So let's continue. Let's just finish number one because my time is running out so that I can save my recording. Okay, so we have done the risk assessment procedures. We have done performance of materiality. Then the last part of question number one, it was there is a great deal of terminology in auditing and sampling. And sampling is no exception. ISA 530 audit sampling includes the following terminology: audit sampling, population, then sampling risk, and then statistical sampling, non-statistical sampling. So define each of the above terms. So this was simple. Audit sampling is just the application of audit procedures to less than 100% of the population. With the objective of actually expressing a conclusion, not actually expressing, but giving a conclusion on the total population. So that is the definition according to the standard. We can just go to the standard and see whether the definition is correct. So in terms of standard, they're saying audit sampling, the application of audit procedures to less than 100% of items within a population of relevance such that all sampling units have the chance of selection in order to provide the auditor with a reasonable basis on which not to draw conclusions about the entire population. Okay, so it's just the application of audit procedures to less than 100%. So that you can actually conclude. So our conclusion is actually on the total population, but we are not going to examine the whole population, but rather we're going to examine only a sample. What is a population? Population is just a set of all the items that make up whatever account. But let's say we are auditing revenue. So the total invoice that are adding up to that revenue figure becomes our population. In terms of the standards, it defines as the population is the entire set of data from which a sample is selected and about which the auditor wishes to draw conclusions. Okay, then sampling risk is the risk that the conclusion that will be reached by the auditor will be different from, okay, we said is the risk that the conclusion that will be reached by the auditor based on the sample will actually be different from the risk that he would have reached had the whole population been subjected to the same audit procedure. That is the sampling risk. And then the standard also says the risk that the auditor's conclusion based on a sample may be different from the conclusion if the entire population was subjected to this same audit procedure. Then what is statistical sampling? This one is simple. We just say statistical sampling is any sampling method with the following characteristics. The first characteristic is the random selection of the sample, and then number two, the use of probability theory. The probability theory, we use probability theory when and where, when evaluating the sampling results and also when we are measuring sampling risk. So by probability theory, we are just talking about quantitative analysis using figures to formulate conclusions. That is sampling as statistical sampling. So statistical sampling, in terms of the standard, it says, where is statistical sampling? Number G, an approach to sampling that is the following characteristics: random selection of sample items and the use of probability theory to evaluate sample results and including measuring the sampling risk. Okay, then non-statistical sampling, non-sampling risk, or non-sampling risk is just the risk that the auditor will actually reach an inappropriate conclusion, but which is not related to the symbol. Okay, in approach, where is non-assembling risk? The risk that the auditor reaches an erroneous conclusion for any reason not related to assembling risk. Okay, so we have covered question number one. So I'm just going to stop for 1 minute so that I save my recording. Then we can resume on assembling. I think we need to do some few calculations before we proceed to question number two.